works like Notting Hill, and we'll be looking at some of that work, but also in television. So it's an opportunity, given the context, to try and focus more on the question of producers, the relationship between producer and director, the freedom of the director, which means we're really going to have to put to one side a lot of other interesting discussions, which I would like to, which I think we'll touch on, which are relationships with writers, because he's worked with very interesting writers like Hanif Qureshi over at least three films, I think. And also, and we'll see this in the clips, what I sense is a very close relationship, an interest in working with actors. We're going to see a little bit of Daniel Craig today, who we now, of course, know in a different role, but working also with very interesting actors like Peter O'Toole in older life. And that leads on also to the sorts of subjects that he's worked in that I'd like to look at. But what I wanted to do was very quickly sketch in the career. We have a limited amount of time. We'd like to open it up to you for 10 or 15 minutes at the end for discussion and questions. But let's just try and draw out the career a little bit as much as anything else. And so it seems very appropriate to start with Notting Hill, a film that you will probably know, but it's quite useful to refresh it. And I think it's also nice to point out that once again there's a mixture that you see in the rest of the career as well between using American actors and using UK actors, and in this case obviously Hugh Grant and Julia Roberts. This was a film that was with one of the most high-profile English production companies working title, and in a sense I think it could be said to be a follow-on from the very successful Four Weddings and a Funeral. So that in the sense there's again working with an ensemble of actors. And so let's start anyway with just a quick clip at which Hugh Grant has been, in his own particular amusing way, trying to make a date with Julia Roberts, and she responds, and he's taking her to a party with family and friends. Just have a look at a minute.
You'll be my date to my little sister's birthday party.
If it's all right.
Well, yeah, I'm sure it's all right. My friend Max is cooking, and he is generally acknowledged to be the worst cook in the world. But, you know, you could hide the food in your handbag or something.
Okay.
Okay.
He's bringing a girl.
Miracles do happen.
Does the girl have a name?
Don't know, wouldn't say.
Oh, Christ, what is going on in there? Oh, God. Like, come on in, fake food crisis.
Hiya. Sorry, the guinea fowl is proving more complicated than expected.
He's cooking guinea fowl?
Don't even ask.
Hi.
Hi. Good Lord, you're the spitting image of...
Bella, this is Anna.
Right.
Okay, crisis over.
Max, this is Anna.
Hi.
Hello, Anna. Scott. Have some wine.
Thank you.
I'll get it.
Red or white?
Oh. Hi. Oh, yes, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Look.
You'd made three features before that, but was that a feature that lifted your profile to a different level? Or?
Yeah, absolutely, yes. That was one of the few scripts in my career that actually literally came through my letterbox with a satisfactory crump and landed on my doormat. I didn't know Richard Curtis or Duncan Kenworthy, the producer of the film. And I don't really know, and I still don't really understand why they wanted me to direct it, but I'm very glad that they did. The pressure I felt was exacerbated by the success of Four Weddings and a Funeral, which in the UK at least was a phenomenon par excellence. And I also thought it was a very, very well-directed film by Mike Newell, an extremely well-made film. And so I thought, I'm on a hiding to nothing here. This film's not only got to be, you know, better than its predecessor, it's also in some way got to be different, got to be a development. So I went with some trepidation into this vast production. My previous films had been quite low budget, quite modest, British, as you say, British independent films. And it was a big adventure. You know, it was my first time working with a big American studio. Bizarrely, during the production, Polygram, who initially owned Working Title, went down the tubes, and Universal took over. So halfway through the production, this became, instead of a Polygram film, it became a Universal Studios film. So I was thrown into the huge sort of machine of a massive American studio with previews, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, which was exciting because the film was successful. If the film had tested badly, it would have been a very different type of adventure. I took the film to America for its first test in Baltimore. And in fact, I took my son with me, who was only 4 or 5, as an adventure. And we flew on Virgin Atlantic, and my son was delighted because he got given a satchel, and there were special games he could play on the plane, et cetera, et cetera. And the film tested so well that they said, would you like to fly back on Concorde? And I said, yes, we'd love to do that. My son will be thrilled by that. And of course, he got onto Concorde, and there was no television, and no hamburgers, and no ice cream, and he complained all the way home.
I suppose one of the things I hadn't quite realized, I mean, I wanted to open up, in a way, a contrast between what, in first appearance, looks like a UK film, Notting Hill, and then show a little bit of Changing Lanes. But you've already spoilt my line of thinking.
I do apologize.
by pointing out that the Notting Hill was actually an American studio film, in a way.
It certainly became one, and crucially in its distribution. It was a studio film, and the huge, I mean, as I'm sure you all know, studios customarily far exceed the budget of the film in the money that they devote to P&A. It's very frustrating often when you're making a film and you're kind of scrimping and savoring every cent to find that once the film is completed and it goes into distribution, there seems to be absolutely no limit to the amount of money that the studio will squander upon what seem often to be rather pointless exercises in presenting and promoting the film.
As a way of moving us into Changing Lanes, I mean, could you say a little bit about your encounter there with American Studio and the idea of the producer that exists there? Because it seems to me that something we might look at in this conversation is the role of the producer in the States, in the bigger system, and then coming back to looking at later work of yours in the UK.
Well, I think as you've sort of outlined, my career falls into two different bits. One are smallish, independent British films, which hover around the $3 to $5 million mark. And the other are large budget, two or three large budget American films, which I try and do perhaps one every 3 or 4 years in order to actually to subsidize the work that I do in England, because I obviously get paid much better to do a big American film than a small English film. And I think that the first thing to say is that you are working to very different types of requirements. When you sign up to do a big studio film, you are undertaking to do something very different from when you make a small personal art film. And you need to take on that responsibility, and there's no point in pretending that you're making the film just for your own pleasure. You're making the film in a huge factory, an industry, if you like, who make films for a profit. They're not making them for fun. They're not making them for sort of nutritional reasons. They're making them to make money. And I think that you have to be a bit grown up about that when you make a film in America with a Hollywood studio. Don't expect to be treated like an auteur. You're part of the machine, and you must respond to the way in which the machine needs to move. By that I mean you should make the film that you think is as good as possible, but don't expect anyone there to be sentimental about it. They're there to make money.
So speaking of making money, let's have a look at Changing Lanes, a little brief extract, which actually is, in a way, essential to the... It's really driving the plot in a very skillful way, because there are the two characters, Ben Affleck and Samuel Jackson, are going to be in conflict through the rest of the film. Ben Affleck is a lawyer who's dealing with a rather difficult and somewhat corrupt case, which he has to try and defend in a way. And Samuel Jackson is a recovering alcoholic who is wanting to do everything by the book. And the documents that they handle in this scene, one of them anyway, is going to become very important in the rest of the film. And I wanted to show this clip partly because of the question of scale and amount of money that's involved in setting up a scene like this. So, please.
Ellen, call the courthouse and tell them I'm going to be late. You know what? Just call Kaufman's office and tell him that I called to say that I'm going to be late, okay?
Your Honor, I'm representing myself today because I want you to hear the sincerity of my words. Boys need their fathers. The boys need their fathers.
Don't do that.
I'll do what I have to.
I'm sorry, not you.
I have to do this right, you know what I mean?
Yes, I think so. Oh, I do.
Gavin.
Yes,
clean.
Hold on a second.
Okay. In all my actions.
Hold on for one second, okay?
What do you want me to do?
Call the court and tell them that I'm on my way, all right?
Okay.
Okay, that I'm going to tell them I'm on the steps. Okay, thank you.
It's only going to take 5 minutes.
All right, but I got to be somewhere like 5 minutes.
You know, you really should keep your card and your glove compartment, not your briefcase.
That's not what I'm looking for. Come on. Thank you. Thank you. Very nice. Okay. Listen, tell you what. I'm going to write you a blank check, and you just can't get your car fixed.
No.
Did I lunch?
I don't want to check, man.
Don't worry about it.
I want to do this right.
Come on.
Oh, look,
please.
I got to be someplace else, too. But it's important to me that we do this right. It should be important to you, too.
Sorry. I got to go.
You sorry what?
I got to go, man. I'm late. I have to go.
I got to go somewhere, too, man. Can I get a lift?
I'm sorry.
Where are you going, man? Come on, man. Don't leave me out here like this, man.
Better luck next time.
Hey, you're leaving the scene of an accident.
One of the things that's very striking in the whole film is that there is a very strong discussion within a genre film, in a way, of morality. I mean, and what you've spoken, obviously, just now of becoming part of a machine. But in what way does what freedom do you have, but what involvement do you have in a particular project with ideas that you might want to express?
Well, this is a good example. I mean, this was a very complex script written by Michael Tolkien, partly by Michael Tolkien, a novelist who wrote The Player, amongst other things, which attracted me because, it, as you say, it was a sort of morality tale masquerading as a kind of vendetta slash action movie. And I think that we succeeded in smuggling quite a complicated story into the multiplexes. It did very well in America and around the world, even though it's a story of character and of some moral depth, as you say. However, having finished my version of the film and shown it to the then head of the studio, who literally fell upon me and burst into tears and said it was a work of genius, etc. Never take anyone who calls you a genius seriously, in my opinion, because they're always wrong. We then tested the film and found that the ending was deeply unpopular amongst the popcorn audience of Middle America. So I then started to call the film Changing Endings, because we then shot two or three different endings, which we constantly recut and retested until the preview audience yielded their approval. And I thought that that was damaging to the film. But as I explained earlier, I thought that was part of my deal with the studio to be grown up about it. And what happened was the film then came out, did well, got generally great reviews, apart from the reviewers who said, shame about the cheesy ending, you know. So I'll always regret the slight smell of fromage that surrounds the end of the film. But that's the deal. I mean, talking about that scene is quite interesting. That scene involved closing down a very important highway in Manhattan. I mean, I'm not sure you could do that now. The FDR freeway, we got permission from the then mayor to close that down every Sunday for four successive Sundays. And we would shoot those sequences. We'd go back every Sunday in the cold to complete those very difficult scenes. So all the cars, for example, that you saw in all those shots were all our cars. They were all driven by stunt drivers. So you start to imagine the sort of scale and size of the hassle and expense. The enormity of it is mind-boggling. And indeed, I felt making that film that we were overmanned. That everyone, there seemed to be two people for every job, as far as I could see. And I started to feel claustrophobic at the idea that when I would turn up to shoot a two-hander scene, for example, in a cafe, the film is mostly two-handers, as you can see, a two-hander scene in a cafe would require us to close down three blocks of New York for all the trailers, the equipment, the generators, the ancillaries, the catering, the people catering for the caterers, the drivers of the drivers, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I found this rather repellent. And I found it also rather repellent that whenever I made a break for it, say there was a little gap in, you know, when they were lighting, and I said, I'm going to go down to the local Starbucks to get myself an espresso, I would clearly be trailed. I'd be tracked. I'd see suspicious ADs lurking in shop windows, sort of looking at me to see what I was up to, whether I was kind of going straying too far from the machine. So I found that tough. I mean, exciting, but then tough. So when I came back from America after making that film, I made a film which I think you're going to show a clip of next called The Mother. And I calculated that I could have made 32 mothers for one Changing Lanes.
Can you say what the budget was for The Mother?
I think The Mother was £1 million.
Which is astonishing. I think this is a very good introduction that you've just made to the complete contrast to what we're going to look at. And it seemed to me as well, looking at your career and looking at films that are coming up like Enduring Love and Venus, that there's a real shift that maybe was a consequence of making of that Hollywood experience that you've just described, or?
Yeah, I mean, it was partly a financial consequence of being able to then stay in England and make small films. It was partly a domestic requirement that I wanted to stay with young children who were based in London, but also partly a kind of choice about the material. And, you know, ultimately, one should always, as a director, be led by the nose to the material that you find most most unavoidable, if you like. And the Mother was a film which I made in a particular way as a result of changing lanes. It's a film where we didn't have a generator, where the DP was cast on the basis of, do you think you can make this film either with available light or with the light that you can plug into a domestic room. And that's quite, I think, common now to make films in that way, now that digital technology allows you to work with hardly any artificial light. But back then, we're talking about 12, 13 years ago, it was still a sort of an exciting departure to work with such a tiny crew. And after changing lanes, it was thrilling to be able to sort of reach out and be in touch with all your departments in the room, really, as opposed to the vast sort of Byzantine labyrinth of a big production.
Let's come back to the role of the producer after we've looked, because it's a sort of turning point, it seems to me, in various ways. But also, I think one of the things to say about this film as well is that it begins for Roger a touch on, shall we say, well, I use the word hesitantly, but more controversial, stronger subjects, because this film, The Mother, is about, or involves anyway, a relationship between a younger man, Daniel Craig, who is, at the scene we're going to see now, he's actually working in the house of the daughter, the son and daughter, so daughter-in-law of the mother who's come to visit. And her husband has just died and she's recovering, but she's getting a sense of a new life. And the film is going to involve a relationship between a quite older woman played by Anne Reed, very remarkably, and I wanted to emphasize that because you can see this in the clip, how good she is, and as is Daniel Craig. So this is the point at which she's beginning to express her interest in him.
Is my daughter talented, do you think?
I really love her voice when she reads to me.
Do you believe in her, then?
Good luck to her in whatever she wants to do.
But it's not necessarily how she should spend her life.
I don't know. Who knows the answer to how anybody should spend their life?
I thought yesterday. Now all I want to do are interesting things. Things I love.
Thank you for that. I'd better get back. Helen will think I'm slacking.
Yeah, she's very,
Very, very. She's jealous of you, that's all.
Me?
Yeah, she's jealous of everybody.
How do you deal with her?
Tell her she looks like Jean Shrimpton.
Every day?
Yeah. Well, it's a calming effect on most women, I find.
Yeah, I suppose it would.
Sorry?
I said, dear God, let us be alive before we die.
Hey, we'll have lunch, shall we?
Shall we?
Yeah.
There's already a lot to talk about, but let's concentrate a little bit on the question of producer, and we'll probably digress a little. But this seems to, this, as far as I can tell, was a film which marked the formation of a new company, Free Range Films, and a continuing career with the producer Kevin Loder, who has also done other films. I mean, he's done, for instance, Brideshead Revisited, In the Loop, Wuthering Heights, Lady in the Van, whatever. But you've worked together very consistently over the
rest of it. Yeah, we have. We started, we started doing another project by Hanif Qureshi, which Hanif and I adapted for British television, called The Buddha of Suburbia. And Kevin produced that, I think that's around 22 years ago, I think. So ever since then, Kevin and I have worked together. We made a couple of documentaries together for BBC Omnibus. And then this was, as you say, this was the first free-range film outing. We formed the company, and we've made six or seven pieces since then through our company. This was an interesting film to finance because, as you can see from that little clip, it's about a sort of a strange taboo, the breaking of the taboo that an older woman, a granny, if you like, should have sexual longing and indeed sexual relations with a much younger man who happens to be her son-in-law. So she's breaking two terrible rules by making the choices that she makes in the film. And it was interesting when we started to try and find funding for the film, and this was an interesting lesson for me, was that lots of financial sources would say, oh, we quite like this if you can cast, you know, could you cast, let's say, Judi Dench in the role, or could you cast Gene Shrimpton in the role, or could, you know, in other words, could you cast some, not only someone very well known, but somebody who has a kind of hinterland of very sexy roles in their youth. Julie Christie was also put forward to us. And it seemed to us that the whole point of the film was that this woman was, it was going to be a surprise that this woman became a sort of a siren, and that it would really ruin the whole purpose of the film to cast somebody famous for those kind of roles. So we ended up lowering the budget until such a point where we could cast who we liked, and we cast Annie Reed. So that's become our way of making films now. Since then, we get the scripts kind of where we want it. We cast it. You know, we cast Jim Broadbent, Lindsay Duncan, or whoever it is. We work out a budget which is as tiny as it possibly can be, and only at that point do we go and try and raise funds. Because at that point, there's no point in the person saying, well, you know, we quite like this, but can you give it a happy ending? We quite like this, but could you get, you know, Tom Cruise to be in it? Can you get a bigger star to be in it? So in a way, it sort of makes us armoured against those often very unhelpful suggestions. Here's the deal, here's the budget, here's the cast, here's the script, let us know, you know, quickly. And that's, we found the most efficacious way of getting these little films going.
So what you're describing in a way is a completely different sort of relationship between director and producer, in which you're almost hand in glove with each other in a way, which is...
Yeah, we are. We're kind of partners. We share the jobs, and we don't have the sort of a simple delineation between our jobs. So yes, that's true. But I think that's quite a special case.
Do you think that's a special case even in the UK? Or?
I think so. I think directors and producers are very lucky if they can remain monogamous in that way. I mean, as you say, Kevin goes off and does other things, and I go off and do other things. But we have an office, we have a company, we are constantly in the process of developing. As you all know, developing can take, you know, a decade. It can take a month, or it can take a decade. So we have lots of things in sort of deep cover, which is slowly evolving. We've just started, and we might get on to talking about television later, but we've just started developing a slate of television, long form television, that we want to slowly get going over the next 18 months. Two of those are now in commission with broadcasters. So it's an ongoing it's an ongoing thing. And as I said, we're in pre-production on our next film at the moment.
Let's take, I mean, I think that's a good introduction to look at a film you made, I think, 4 years later than this, which is Le Weekend. I mean, before that, I think it's worth mentioning that you touched on another taboo subject, which was the film Venus, which we won't show a clip from, but which has a marvelous performance by Peter O'Toole, who must have been 75, 80, and a younger girl. And it's a virtuoso piece of acting on both their behalves. But it clearly, again, touches on something that is very tricky to deal with and presumably quite tricky to finance. I mean, just to ask that, I mean, was when you, and also again with Hanif Qureshi, who has a taste for, shall we say, taboo subjects as a writer and in collaboration with you. I mean, again, was that a film that you had the script sorted in the way that you've just described and then you went to seek finance?
Exactly. We had a script which was more or less done. We attached Peter to the project. We made a budget, and we then took the budget to, I think it was Miramax, and to Film 4. Yeah, and even then there are kind of, well, does it have to be like this, and is it a bit, you know, is it going to be a bit seedy, and we're a bit worried about this, and you just have to say, well, that's what we're doing. So it's, you know, if you don't want to do it, that's fine. But it gives you so much more confidence if you can say, this is the project that we believe in, this is what we want to make, and we really don't mind if you don't want to help us make it. But if you do want to help us make it, this is what it is, and this is what it's going to feel like.
I can't help asking two questions. One was whether you already had Peter O'Toole in mind, and then rather differently, Miramax is famous for various forms of intervention with films. Were they actually leaving you alone?
Well, that's a good question, but it's misguided, because Harvey had already sold Miramax. Post-Harvey Miramax. I don't know what Harvey would have made of this film, and I would be very, very careful about... working with Harvey, not because I don't think he's a marvelous force for cinema, but because I don't really like that much help making a film.
Let's change the subject, shall we? Let's take a look at Le Weekend, which again is in many ways a two-hander. And it's about a couple, aging couple, nearing retirement, I think it's fair to say, who go back to Paris. It's again written by Hanif Qureshi. And they go back to Paris to rediscover their youth in a way, and the film is about that. It's about the exploration of their relationship. And this is a scene when they've actually gone back to the original hotel that they stayed in, presumably when they were in their 20s. And the woman is outraged, and they go in seek of another hotel. And this scene is the moment when they're about to get involved in this new hotel. And it's got wonderful performances by Jim Broadbent and Lindsay Duncan.
Paris.
Regardez le compteur pour 60 euros, monsieur.
Combien? Combien? Non, monsieur.
Monsieur, no, no.
Whatever it costs is fine.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
I'm so sorry, madam, but unless you made a reservation, we are completely and utterly full.
You see? They've taken our bags.
Can you tell us the way to
the... What now, back on the train?
Good idea.
Bit of a taxi to the garden and all? Sit in silence all the way back to Moseley before killing ourselves in a suicide pact.
Perfect.
I knew this trip would be a fucking disaster. You didn't even want to try.
I did. But why did you book that dreadful place?
I was foolish enough to want to try and please you. You actually said you wanted to go back.
Not that far.
Madame?
Anyway, it was the wrong place.
It wasn't.
It was.
It wasn't. They just redecorated, that's all.
Madame, there is one possibility.
There is?
As a special offer, we have a prestige suite available for two nights. In fact, Tony Blair once slept there.
Well?
As long as they change the sheets.
Thank you.
Could you say a little bit about the relationship? I mean, you've already described a little bit the relationship between producer and director, but how did it work, for instance, on a film like that, which between producer, director, and scriptwriter? Because again, it's Hanif Qureshi.
Well, we started discussing, Hanif and I started discussing this film as we were promoting the one before, which was Venus. So there were 7 years between Venus and The Weeknd, and it took that long for this film to arrive fully formed. But we started on these promotional tours. There's lots of time in aeroplanes to talk about what we wanted to do next, and little bits of that story have found their way into this film. We were in Los Angeles. Kevin was phoning his wife. They'd just moved into a new house with a baby. There were rats in the house. They bought this house, which was infested with rats. And so that's found its way into this screenplay, where the children have finally left home, and they've moved into a house with a little baby, and they've discovered rats. So it's full of autobiography, if you like. It's really the way Hanif and I have really worked over the years, is over a very long period, meeting occasionally, putting it away, putting it in a drawer, forgetting about it, then doing perhaps reading it with some actors. We read this around a kitchen table a couple of times, trying to find the way forward, trying to improve it, until eventually it all comes together. There's the script. There's Lindsay, there's Jim, they've all agreed. We make a very, again, very small budget. The film is, in a way, a kind of homage to Nouvelle Vague films. It's called Weekend, Le Weekend, not Weekend. And we shot it like that. We shot it handheld. We shot it with a French documentary-making filmmaker. We shot it with available light. We had a great time, you know, running around Paris like kids, and we shot it in 20 days, something like that, for about £1.7 million.
With a film like that, did you stick strictly to the script, or did the actors improvise at all? Or?
There's a little bit of improvisation. I mean, there's a little bit of stuff that happens on the day, but most of what's in the film was in the screenplay.
And in terms of casting, I mean, they seem both so perfect. But, I mean, were they original choices, or how did that...?
Lindsay was always in our heads. Jim, there was another actor who was involved for a little bit and then decided they didn't feel old enough to do a role that contained so many potential indignities, perhaps. and so we got lucky, and we got Jim, who I can't imagine anyone else doing the part so beautifully. And it's so much like a, you know, Jim is so revealed in it. You know, Jim is famous for doing quite sort of large character performances. And indeed, he's just opened in Scrooge in the West End this week. But here I feel I'm getting a bit of Jim as well as a bit of his character, which is terrific.
I mean, during this period, you also, made a couple of films. There was Morning Glory, which was a US production, I think. But there was also, and again, we're not going to have a clip from it, but Hyde Park on Hudson, which was an interesting film because it was all shot in the UK, but in a sense had the flavor of an American film. And I meant to mention that, I mean, you've very skillfully through a number of films, I mean, and talking of Jeff Le Weekend, you include Jeff Goldblum. So is that a sort of financing calculation in the case of Le Weekend to have an American actor in it?
No, I don't think Jeff brought any more money to the table. And in fact, I think we cast Jeff after we'd had the film financed. But I knew Jeff from Morning Glory. And we actually ended up really writing that part for Jeff. And then blow me down, he said he would like to do it. I mean, he was only with us for like 3 days, but he has a super and large impact on the film, I think you'd agree. And then Hyde Park on Hudson was with the elusive Bill Murray, who's famously untraceable. You know, he doesn't have an agent. He has a lawyer. But he pointed out to me that if anybody ever calls his lawyer, who never knows where Bill Murray is, all it does is cost Bill Murray money in lawyer's fees. So you end up sort of tracing Bill Murray like a yeti, like a sort of a wild fictional animal, and then one day without any warning, you know, your mobile phone goes and someone pretending to be Bill Murray turns out to be Bill Murray. And it was funded by Focus, Hyde Park on Hudson, and it wasn't that cheap. It was probably about $15 million. And they'd worked with Bill Murray before. They did Lost in Translation with Bill Murray. And it was on off with Bill whether he would do the film. And we got into pre-production, and there would not have been a film without Bill hadn't signed up for it. And after about 2 months of pre-production, I received a text from Bill Murray saying, I'm at Atlanta, I'm going to the Gulf, I'm very excited about our film, have got some FDR books, see you later. And I showed the text to Focus in lieu of a contract, and they said, yeah, that's fine, you'll do it, here's the money. So good for them and good for him.
I mean, it's very interesting the way that you're keeping, you're balancing these two different scales of production. And in a sense, we're now even going to drop down a little bit, I think, with looking at the last couple of years while in pre-production or preparation of other projects, like we talk about in a moment. You made a couple of films for TV. And we're going to show a little clip from The Lost Honor of Christopher Jeffries. And that was a two-part TV. Again, it's centered on a virtuoso piece of acting, which won a BAFTA award, I think. And I wondered if you'd like to, perhaps you could introduce that. We're just showing the beginning of the film where he's, you know, being introduced as a character. But perhaps you could say something.
Yeah, sure. This was a two 90s for ITV, written by Peter Morgan, who's famous for Rush, The Queen, et cetera, et cetera. And it's about, as with all Peter Morgan's films, it's about a real person and a real story. And the story is a retired school teacher in Bristol, which is the west of England, who 4 or 5 years ago, I think 5 years this Christmas, was accused of murdering his tenant. She was called Joanna Yates. And because she was middle class, because she was blonde, because she was pretty, and because she disappeared at Christmas, it became a huge, huge story in the UK. And tragically, her body was even discovered in the snow on Christmas Day. Christopher Jeffries, her landlord, who is an odd-looking, or was an odd-looking and eccentric man, was then arrested for her murder. And whilst he was in custody, the police having let the press know that they were pretty sure they got their man. It was the landlord what did it. As he was in custody, he was traduced by the British press, who, as I'm sure you know, are the, in some ways the worst in the world at this kind of hysteria, this kind of vindictive hysteria. He was then released from custody on police bail, and the culprit was caught. And this is a story, really, then about how what happened to this man whose life was in tatters. You know, he couldn't go back to his house. He was being sort of yelled at in public, blah, 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 blah. And it, by chance, he was also my English teacher at school. So this was a labor of love in a way, but also, I think, a superscript by Peter Morgan and an interesting piece to do.
So as I say, this is just close to the beginning of the film, introducing the character.
And some sourdough bread too, please, Janine.
We've run out on fragrance fruit.
Already? It's 9:15.
I know.
The sourdough bread stampede has preceded me.
Christmas jockey.
Just a reminder to everyone else that next week, in regards to the possible charitable cause for next year's summer party, we have a representative from the Salvation Army coming in to talk to us, which I am sure will be extremely...
Et naturel par origine. Vertu d'autre part est artificiel, surnaturel, car à chaque époque...
Today's match against
Wolves, the oldest Christmas event. Slow it down.
What sort of budget was that?
Well, I was interested, Simon, that you said it was sort of like a step down.
Yeah, wasn't at all.
I thought that was an interesting... And 5 years ago, I think I would have agreed with you. But now I think television is the new frontier for people dealing with serious material. And significantly, the budget per hour for this was considerably higher than The Weeknd, for example. Nowadays in the UK, you get a tax credit if your budget is above 1 million per hour. So in ITV terms, this is getting a bit technical now, but a 90-minute ITV program, you qualify for a tax credit, even though the filmed component of that is only just over 1 hour. So you get the budget for this was three million quid for effectively the length of a long feature film. So I didn't feel, on the contrary, I didn't feel any kind of technical or budgetary restraints. I had a nice long shoot. I had a super, you know, cinema crew. And the whole thing was a pretty good experience.
How does the producer or funder relationship differ when you're making a film with somebody like ITV, as against, I mean, in a number of the other films we've been discussing, a BBC or Film 4, I think, yeah, where the major finance is?
Well, this film was made for Carnival Films for ITV. So Carnival were the sort of generator of the film. They paid for the script, they owned the script. They'd commissioned Peter before I was attached to this. And Carnival are most famous, I think, probably for Downton. They produced Downton Abbey. And so they are exceeding wealthy. So they more or less left us to our own devices. When the film was cut, it was submitted to ITV, who were exemplary and very restrained in their notes, and so it was really a painless process.
This is the time, I think, where we should open it up to other questions from the floor. I would love to talk about other things as well, but let you come in. Yeah, please, there's a question here. We have a mic, I think, that runs around.
Thanks very much for the
fascinating session. I just wanted to ask you about working with actors, because you've spoken a lot about other things, but just the craft of getting performances out of actors and working with actors. And also, in the casting process, what are you looking for from an actor in casting a particular role?
That's a good question and a huge subject. My background is in theatre. I started off in theatre. I spent the first 15 years of my career just directing plays. So I like, and I'm used to spending time in rooms with actors. And it's very much a part of my process is to have a proper rehearsal time with the actors before I start shooting. And I'm really not saying that that's the way for everybody, but it happens to be my way. It gives me pleasure and confidence to work in a room with the actors without anyone else there, you know, without producers, without production assistants, without anybody, so that the actor is free to feel foolish, be foolish, experiment, try things in a room. So that's my approach to making films. So that on the day when it's 6 o'clock in the morning and there are 100 people sort of milling around, you don't ever have an actor coming up to you and saying, I just don't know what I'm doing in this scene, because that seems to me to be the most scary thing I can imagine. You know, you want to be very productive on a set. You want to get shooting as soon as possible. And I don't like sitting around trying to nut out what a scene means on a set. I like doing that in a room. As the second part of your question was about casting. It's all about the particularity of the role, trying to find the best match for you as a director. As I get older, I get lazier and lazier, and if I can get someone who's more and more suitable for the part, then that means that you don't have to work so hard as a director. When I started out, I thought, oh, I'm a genius, I can get any actor to do any role. That's wrong. You know, you really can give yourself a huge head start if you take time to cast things carefully and properly.
Other question, one here and then one there. Yeah, here, yeah.
Thank you, hi. Improvisation on the set, how much is practical in terms of the budget and money?
I think it's always good to have a plan for what you want to do on the set and for everyone to know that you have a plan. And then you can improvise around that plan, or you can even throw away the plan if you feel that something else is going to be a better solution to the scene, either in terms of the text, the acting, or the way you've staged it, or you want to shoot it. But my advice to all directors is have something in your back pocket that you can fall back on, because often during a shoot you get progressively more and more tired, and often the last moment to feel inspirational is on the set. You know, you feel inspirational as you prepare your film, and sometimes you feel inspirational when you cut your film. But I would advise directors, don't expect to feel inspirational in the middle of your shoot, because all you'll feel will be tired.
Question,
yeah, I was just going to ask, if you could go back and give yourself one piece of advice when you were just starting out, what would that piece of advice be?
God. Just sort of go to more parties, I think. I mean, really, you know, I was so ambitious in my 20s. I think I should have gone to some more parties. But I'm trying to make up for that now.
One here, yeah. And then the lady in red.
Hello. A question about your decision-making process. You mentioned that, you know, when you were doing Changing Lanes, for example, you know, you use the term you have to sometimes be grown up about things. And then after that, you know, you were less willing to make compromises. How do you know whether in a certain context, whether this is something I should compromise upon or I should be grown up about it?
That's such a good question. And I think the answer is really have very big ears. So I have Final Cut on the little films I make. I have Final Cut, which makes me listen much more carefully to the voices around me, the people who say, have you thought about this? We're not sure about that. So I think if you really listen carefully and you start to add up the voices that are saying the same thing, then you should probably act upon what they're saying. But it's a balance, isn't it, between sticking to what you think is right and being then prepared to be wrong and say, actually, I'm going to make that adjustment.
Thank you.
The lady in red and then the gentleman in the back.
Thank you. I've enjoyed this afternoon immensely. I wanted to follow up a little bit on casting, but also about market appeal and the different levels of filmmaking that you're working on. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe when Notting Hill was released, there was a little bit of controversy about the lack of diversity. And with the shift in the global marketplace, far more to global versus North America, do you feel under pressure to diversify in your casting?
Well, I mean, you're right about Notting Hill and diversity. That felt odd to a lot of people, that it was that it was set in Notting Hill, which is famously a very diverse, or was, less so now perhaps, because of films like Notting Hill, was a very diverse area. And that was something that I felt was an error. I think you have to be very responsible about diversity, but you have to be really responsible to the story you're trying to tell as well. And I think that if you make the kind of films that I make, which aren't actually geared for success, by that I mean they're not trying to reverse into a niche. They're not trying to be particularly successful in any market. They're simply trying to be themselves. And if the budget is low enough, then they can afford to do that. Do you see what I mean? Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. But now for the weekend, did you actually make that for the television market specifically? It was a lower budget film. I'm just wondering.
The weekend? Do you mean?
Yes, I'm just wondering if you're still getting back your earnings, because that's been a problem, British cinema, that low-budget features, yeah, that were grant-funded didn't make earnings, that did not produce revenue.
Yeah. Film Le Weekend wasn't made for television, but it has had a successful... it's earned far, far more than it cost, but only because we made it for such a little amount.
Okay, thank you.
There's a question there, yeah.
Just wanted to ask about your style when you cast someone and when you're on set and when you think the actor is, or when they do a certain scene, and then you're not feeling they're giving you what you want. How would you communicate to them? How would you show them? I mean, would you show them what's the right way? Would you tell them to recall a certain emotion or something? I mean, how do you direct them?
Well, each actor is different, and each actor needs approaching differently and coaxing or cajoling or encouraging differently. But as a general rule, I wouldn't show. I don't show the actor. I think actors find that difficult. Sometimes they want to be shown, but I think it's better to try and quietly explain where you think the gaps are, how things could be better. Or simply say, you know, do it more like a bit more like this, or a little bit more like this. Or say, I think we've got a good take. Why don't you just do one where you do what you like, or do one where you do this in a ridiculous way, or do you see what I mean? And go fishing, in other words. And you never know, you might catch something good.
One last question. That's somebody right at the back.
Have you been in a situation where, while editing, you find that something has been changed, like maybe go to shooting again? What did you do in such a situation?
It's very hard to go back and shoot again, unfortunately. I mean, the editing room is where the editing process is really where you try and eradicate your mistakes, isn't it? So it's a place where you try and prevent the world from seeing what a fool you've made of yourself. And if you have a skillful editor who's helping you, then there's usually a way around the problem. It's very, very infrequent that the will or the resources exist to go back and do big pickups or reshoots.
I'm sorry, we have to end there because the room needs to be rearranged for another session. So apologies to those who still had questions. I still had questions. I think we could have talked for another hour at least. And I'd like to thank Roger Michell very much
thank
for
you.
Being here and being so interesting.